Okay, so now we want to work on our Q&A website to add some state management. This is the application that we had last week. The only difference is visual because I use the React Bootstrap classes to create tables, buttons, and so on. Actually, this application is just working like we had last week with some fake data, okay? Right now, this fake data is used directly to generate the app component. And then you see that the only difference that we had very black and white divs, and right now I use the container, navbar, and so on. Components, React Bootstrap components inside this code. So you're using row and column and the table with a capital T that uses the Bootstrap component. Okay, so, but I only did this modification and the styling with respect to what we had last week, nothing more. Our first question is, okay, if we want to have an application that manages a list of questions and answers and is able to modify, for example, the scores or add a new question or new answer and so on. Of course, this list of answers should be stored in a state variable because it needs to be modified. Okay? We cannot just have these constant fake values that can be done for initialization, but not for the real work of the application. And so our first question is where and how to store this information. So which state variables do we want to use or do we need to use, and where do we not want to store them? Okay. We had a map of the components that we did last week that for example these components have some we decide which properties they received and what they was rendering and what they was were calling. Okay, now we need to, and of course there was the app I didn't And just remember that we have, if we see the code, sorry, we have app that is calling blah, 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 question with answers. So in the tree, we have app that is calling question with answers as a child. And then question with answers is here and is calling question details and answer details. So let's indent them. Question with answer is calling these two, question details and answer details. Question details is just generating text, so it doesn't use any lower component. Answer details contains answer row and new answer form as children. So these are children of answer details. This is our tree of components. We may see here, or we may see it also in the inspector, in the browser. Okay, when we have an app that contains all these on the navigation bar, and then we have question with answers that contains question details, answer details, and then other new answer form and answer row. It's the same tree. So, first question is where do we need to store the information about the questions and the answers? And the answer is in a component that is the common ancestor to every other component that needs to use or to modify those values. For example, which component can be used? One possibility is always up. We put everything, every state at the top level. It's a choice, it's a possibility. And so we are always sure that everything will be a descendant of up. And so when we have this vote button, this vote, we will some way need to modify some information which was defined in a state inside up. Okay. Can we have some store the state somewhere lower in the component tree in this case? Well, I don't know. For example, question details doesn't need to know anything about the answers, for example, nor to modify any of the answers. So in theory, the question details could store the state about the question, but and answer details probably doesn't need any information about the question. While all its children need it. So in theory, one could say, okay, the question details can be a state, the question, the information about the question, the current question should be a state inside the question details component, and information about the answers could be a state inside the answer details. So if you need to partition the state, you can try to move it down to the component that only needs to, and where the component itself and its children need to know only about a part of the state. I'm not suggesting to do this in this exercise. Let's try to do something simpler, to put everything at the top. Because basically we don't know how the state will be loaded. Right now we are loading everything from a fake variable, and I don't want to have fake variables everywhere, okay? So let's start simple and let's put everything in up. But when we go to something more complicated, probably every group of components should manage its own portion of the state. They can do that as long as the same information is not needed by other components, upper or siblings. So the easiest thing, as I mentioned, was to store everything in up. But this reasonment about this reflection about the lower component already teaches us some design principle about the state. It's good to have a partition state. Not having everything in one big object, because if I put all the information in one big object, then we'll surely need to go into the top level component. Because everything is there and somebody needs at least a part of it. It's better to partition the information into subsets that may be useful for different parts of the application. So in a way, we should probably reverse what we did with our libraries, not question answer library. We have one question object that contains answer objects and so on. And so everything is accessible from one big object. Maybe it's better to separate them into two different objects, that one for with the question information and the other with the answer information. Okay, so that they can be updated separately. Or by the way, in this first page, we don't have any functionality for modifying the question, only the answers. So it's even better to keep it separated. We will have some function for modifying the answers, but no function for modifying the question. So there's a tendency in React to decompose state information into many independent state variables, as independent as possible. So that we have one state variable, the callback functions for managing the state variables, and we can pass the values and the callbacks to the component that need it. So in this case, what does it mean? We go to app. Okay. These are our fake data. Let's imagine you obtain some data in some way. Okay. But this will not be the data that we are directly using in our application. By the way, another modification that I did is to add one ID field to question and answers compared to last week's project. Because we will need them. Of course, if I imagine that this data comes from a database, we will always have an ID somewhere. But even here, when I'm trying to say, okay, let's increase the vote of question number one or two, I need some reliable number or reliable ID, you know, to define which question to modify, for example. So I just added one ID field both to the question and answer object. And it's all in the project that we have today. So let's imagine that we have this information some way, and we need to create some state in the application. And for separating the different roles, I would create one state variable for the question and one for the list of answers. Okay? So we can create the question, set question, and answers as a different state variable. Answers. Of course, use state should be imported from React. Like that. Okay, of course, we should specify the initial value in both cases. So we want question to be one single object with the information that we need about the question. Without any reference to the list of answers, because we are separating them. Okay, so we may possibly use, so we cannot use the question object because it contains one field, which is the list of answers. We should create another object that only has information about the question itself. Probably we should imagine, if we had to refactor all our classes, we should probably have one other class which is question with answers. It has two subfields, the question information and the list of answers. And then you have, so that we have separating the objects. Okay? The question object is a bit overloaded because it has information about the question and the reference to the list of answers. And so it's not usable like this. But without doing any heavy refactoring, one simple thing to do is just to create an object like here, an inline object, where we only have, for example, the ID from my question.id. We may extract the text from, sorry, not equal, is a colon. From my question.text. Then we have the author from my question.author. And finally, the date from my question.date. So I'm just creating a simple object. We could do a constructor function with just these fields. Okay, but just for brevity today, I'm just creating an object with these fields. And this is how I decide what kind of information the question state will hold. In a way, I'm committing with myself that the state variable, the question state variable, will always contain an object with these four fields. We initialize it in a way, and then we'll try to keep it consistent. Okay? Let's see if it worked. If I see the components, right now I go to app here. Okay. It's a bit difficult to have everything visible. You see that if I select the app component, okay, it will tell me the props. Right now we have no props for app, and two hooks. And it says, okay, right now you define two hooks, and they are hooks of type state. And they will tell me the current value of these hooks. They are all just called state, state and state. The first and the second state variable. Because useState doesn't have a name here. It just creates an object, and it's just up to me to store this object in a variable name. So the hook itself doesn't have the knowledge of where I'm storing these references. So they only say state, state, and the value itself. There's this magic wand that tries to read the code and to associate the name that they use in the code to what they're showing. Okay, so but just they try to analyze the source code and say, okay, you are storing this into a variable called question. So for helping you, instead of if you have maybe 10 state variables, it will help you to identify them. But what really counts is the order. The first, the second, the third call to state, to the use state hook, will be remembered in the next calls, in the next renderings of the function. This is also the reason why we want and we should put the use state hooks at the beginning of the function. It's forbidden to put a use state under an if statement or under a while loop or under a conditional statement. We must be sure that every time the function is called, the use state calls are executed in the same exact order. You cannot skip one because maybe you don't need it right now. Okay? So the way of being sure that we are executing all of them at the same, always in the same order, is to put them outside any control structure. No if, no while, no for surrounding the use state. So use state should be at the top level of the function. No return statement, no breaks before them, before executing all of them. So usually we dedicate the first line of the function just to create these state variables. Well, there may be some computation here before that, basically to compute what we need for the initialization. but they should be computations that are, you know, always executed, and they never return anything. So you cannot interrupt the function before that. Okay, this is the price that we have to pay. Now there's a rigidity here. The hooks should be activated deterministically at the beginning of a function, and we should ensure that they will always be executed in the same order. It's not difficult, just a rule. And so here we can see the current value of the state. Or maybe any object, for example, the question contains one DJS object inside. It's not a problem, any type of object, okay? And for the list of answers, it's a bit more difficult, but, or maybe not. We might use maybe just my question dot answer list. Answers, because it's already an array of answers. So if I go there, I will see that we have a list of objects, an array of objects at the second state variable. I will do something more, because right now I'm here setting a reference to the content of the fake data. I prefer to have a copy instead of a reference, just for being sure that it's my own copy of the data. But this is just because we have fake data. When in the future, what we are going to do is to load this information from the database. Okay, so there will be a new object that we create from the database itself. So nothing changes here. It's only that we are sure that we have a fresh copy of the array. So we have nothing to do with this fake data anymore. Now the information that my application needs is all in the state variables. And we should also reflect this into our rendering. For example, in question my answers, with answers is not my question, but okay, we split the object in two, so we should pass both the question and the answers as separate properties. Question is question, answers is answers. Of course, right now question with answers will need to be modified, because now it receives a question and maybe the answers. Is props dot answers. So the answer details only receive answers instead of q dot answer that doesn't exist. So it should right now work in the same way. We should have the question details component that receives the two properties, author and text, extracted from the question. Author and text. Because the component question with answers, okay, the one on top receives two properties, the question and the list of answers. It doesn't have any state. The state is all in app. Then question details receives the author and the text, and the answer details receives the answers as a prop. Okay, we just changed the names, but we are propagating copies or the values from the state that was is owned by app. And so everything is recreated in the same way. Okay, they just take the information from a different source. One syntax that you probably see often is instead of writing props.answers or copying to a local variable, many times you see a destruction instruction like this. Instead of receiving one variable props as an argument, you are destructuring this object props into a list of names. And so we are saying question is a props.question. We extract props.question and we store it in a question variable. We extract props.answers and we store it in an answers variable and so on. This is useful if you know what you need and maybe you only want to extract some information for the props. Okay? The general case is always to have the props and then extract the fields. It's a special case of an assignment or a destruction assignment for object properties. I will keep it with props because we are going to add a new props for modifying the state, and so we need to propagate all of them. If you select only some, then you will lose maybe other property that you are going to add in the future. But it's just a syntax that maybe is easier to work, and you can see it somewhere. Okay. So nothing special, apart from app, and the fact that we separated the question from the answers, and question details only receive information about the question, and answer details only receive information about the answers. Everything is still as before. Because every component only works with their own props. Nothing special. Okay? This is the good of components. Once they have the props, they already know what to do. Then a separate issue is how to give them these props. And this is the role of the intelligent components. Okay? Those their own state and have some behavior. Okay, what operations can we do on this list of answers or questions? Let's maybe implement an easy one. Delete an answer. What is a more complex one? Let's imagine we want to delete an answer, okay? Of course, we need to add one button here. And it's easy. We just modify the component answer row. So in answer row, we add a second button. And we call it delete. Oops. Like this. Okay. This is a new button here. We want to associate a behavior to this button. So this button is inside answer details, which is 1, 2, 3 steps removed from app. If we want this button delete to be able to delete one answer, this component, answer details, must have a callback which is able to provide this action. So in app, we should define a function and pass this function down to every component until we find answer details, which is the one that we'll use. Okay, so we must define all the functions that we want to support for managing the state. So one function could be delete answer with an ID, and we'll do something with that question. Okay. Let's console.log, deleting question ID. Sorry, answer ID. Equal to, I wanted to make an arrow function, but okay, maybe an arrow function, maybe a function declared with any of the syntax you prefer. It's just a function, okay? And this function is a callback. Right now we need to implement it, but first let's try to activate it and to propagate it. Then we implement the functionality. We need to propagate this this callback down to the component that needs to call it. That is answer row. So we need, we are in app, we need to, answer row can only receive properties from answer details, and answer details can only receive properties from QED, question with answers. And so we need to pass down through all of these intermediate components the reference to this function. Even if these intermediate components don't need that function, but, and so let's do it. So we have question with answers, we pass the delete answer. Remember, never call this function, okay? Never put the parentheses, always passing the reference. Okay, this goes to question with answers, it's a new prop. Here we have a look here in question with answers, we have a new prop called delete answer, which is point to the function. Now we go inside the component question with answers, because it needs to pass the function, the same function, to its children, at least answer details. Delete answer coming from props dot delete answer. So we are propagating the property that we receive from our father down to one of our children. So right now we have question with answer, received the delete answer, and the answer details received a copy of the very same function. So function defined in app, we pass it as a prop to question with answers, and it paste as a prop to answer details. Answer details needs again to pass it to answer row. That is where the button is located. Okay? So answer details, when it calls an answer row, it needs also to pass the delete answer, a new property with a copy of the property we just received. Yes, it's boring. No, we can do in another way. Or we could, but not today. Delete answer. So right now we are here and we can associate to this delete button the action delete answer. So we are inside answer row, finally. We have this button delete. Let's put a space here. And we associate an action on click. On click of what? We call props dot delete answer, and now we can give the parameter of which answers we want to delete. That is from props dot answers answer dot ID. Beware, this is not correct, because right now with this syntax I'm calling the function delete when I'm rendering the button. Okay, I need to delay the execution of this function when the button is actually clicked. So here I need to set a callback like this. Maybe with a pair of braces just to be clear. Okay, onClick should be a function that is called when the button is clicked. If I didn't have any parameter here, I could just write props dot delete answer. If the function doesn't have any parameter, I just have the reference to the function and it will be called. But if I need to pass some parameter, right now I'm calling the function. So I need to schedule the call, to create one function that calls this, that will call this when the time is right. And that's why we need to, whenever we need to pass some parameters, we can only do that inside a callback. Otherwise, the call will happen immediately when this JSX code is executed. So at the first render, I'm deleting everything. Okay, so this is the right operation. Let's see what happens. Of course, it doesn't disappear, but you see the console here, delete answer 2. And if you click here, delete answer 1. Okay, so actually, when I click on delete, I'm calling this function 3 levels before, that is just doing a console.log. No state is modified, and so no component is re-rendered. But now we can implement the actual deletion of the line from the list of questions. Okay, so just to summarize, we have a state. We defined one possible operation on this state, delete answer, and we propagated this callback, the reference to this callback, down to every component that we possibly needed for itself or for its children. And finally, there's one component that will call this callback with the proper arguments. Okay? We are trusting this component to delete its own ID, not somebody else's ID. Okay, now the actual deletion. We have one state, answers, and we need to create another, which is an array. We need to create another array with the same element except the one we want to delete. Right? We cannot delete the second element or the element with the ID because we cannot mutate the state variable. We should create a new variable with the same structure of the current one, with the same values, except one element will not be copied. And this new variable will be subject of a set answers call. So what we are doing is, let's do one step at a time. The first thing is to create new answers. We are taking one list and one array and creating another array with one less element. We can use a filter for doing that, for example. So it would be answers dot filter, where we survive all the elements that don't have the ID. everything which has, we doesn't have the ID that we want to delete will be filtered okay. So we have a callback with an element of the array, which is an answer. And we return okay whether the answer.id is different from the ID. Right? So it should create a new array with all the elements that don't match this ID that we want to remove. And once we have this, we could schedule an update of the answers with the new answers. When we schedule this, the old state will be replaced by the new array that hopefully will have one less element. And this change of state will re-trigger the rendering of app and recursively the rendering of all the other components below that depend on the answers property that has changed. So let's see if it works. We are not done yet, but let's see. Yeah, they go away. Of course, they are not persistent. If I reload the application, it will reload everything from the fake data. Okay, so delete is a strange word for rebuild something new without one element. Okay, we still have one step to go, because if you look at these two lines, we are doing something that was dangerous. We are updating the state according to its previous value. Right? And this should be delayed in a callback. Right now, you see that we are computing the new list of answers now, and we are asking React to replace this value in the future. And so there is a time interval between now and this future in which the list of answers could change for other reasons, but we are risking of missing these changes. Okay, so again, we are in the rule in which we are setting a state depending on the old value of the state, which is normal, okay, it's the normal case usually. And we should do that in a callback. So this computation here should be delayed. We should take, instead of passing the new object, we should pass a callback that will create a new object. So, taking the old state, all the answers, which are the old in the future, and give me all the answers dot filter, blah, blah, blah. I could do that everything in a row. In a line of code. So this filter operation is delayed until we are ready to apply the state change, and it doesn't work on answers. I don't want to work on a closure on a value which is already old. I work on the parameter that will be fresh. And I create the filter. So right now, it should work in the same way, yes, as before. only that in this case it's also robust against many concurrent operations being done. Okay, so actually this is the code that we need to execute for deleting an answer. There's also a lot of questions here. Okay, what happens if the ID is no longer valid? I'm trying to delete question number two, but in the meantime, the question has been deleted for other reasons. Well, this doesn't, is not a problem because filter just doesn't find the element and will replicate a list of all the others. Okay, it's also easier to manage corner cases. If you had to find an element and delete it, you will get an exception if the element is not there anymore. Right now, we're just taking what is there and recreating something with a new rule. Okay, let's remove the console.log. Okay, so are we ready to implement the other functionality, the voting functionality? Well, the idea would be more or less the same. We define a function called upvote, maybe, and propagate it down, and this function will have to mangle the state of the answers whenever it's called. So means that we have const upvote, upvote answer. Again, with a function that takes an ID and does something. A voting answer ID. Okay. And then we propagate down all the way like we did before. Upvote answer. Let's copy this because I will need to paste it many times. We need to pass it here to question with answers. Then we need to pass to answer details. And from answer details on to answer row equal to props dot upvote answer. And finally, we are in answer row on the vote button. And we can set the onClick action. OnClick equal to JavaScript code callback props dot upvote answer ID. So at the end, we want to execute this code inside the answer row. Remember, always put it in a callback, since we have some parameters to specify. And all the rest is just drilling properties, they call. Like with the drill, you go down, down, down until you find the bottom. So let's see what happens. What? Okay. I have some problem here. Type error is not a function in component 63. Component 63. Prop the upvote answer. Answer row. Ah, sorry. I didn't save it. I didn't save up.js. That was the reason. I didn't save up, and so all these properties were undefined. The new property they added. I want the answer one, answer two, answer one again, and so on. So this is the boring part. And then the actual algorithm should be inside the upvote answer. And in this case, we know the game already. We need to schedule the recreation of a new array where all the elements are the same except one. So what we are doing is something like answers.map. Use a map to rebuild another array with the same element, except one. Of course, it's not answers, because we cannot work on the current state because it may be updated. So we need to schedule in a callback. So let's try to write it correctly the first time. Set answers. Where we have the old answers, and we have an expression for computing the new ones. Okay. So set answer to a callback. This callback, we take the old answers that will be new, will be the future old one answers. And the expression to compute is a mapping of the old answers, so a new array with the same number of elements with some transformation applied to them. And what kind of transformation are we applying? Well, depends. If the element has the ID that we need to upvote, then we need to change the vote. Otherwise, we just replicate the old one. So we take one element, which is an answer. So this is the callback of map, right? And we so in the callback of map, I'm taking one answer and say if the answer.id is ID, then do something. Else, just let's say like this. And doing something like this. If in the mapping I take an element whose ID is the one that I know, I need to modify it. Otherwise, just report the old one. So here, this answer needs to create a new answer object with an updated vote. We cannot modify that object. Okay, we are creating a new array. We are reusing the object that didn't change, but this one needs to change, so we need to create a new object. But it's easy because we have the new answer, where we have the same ID, the same text, the same author, the score plus one, and the same date. So you see what we are doing. We are taking the answers, the array of answers, and we are recreating a new answer where all the elements are the same as before, except the one that matches the ID, which is replaced by a new object computed from the current one. All of this doesn't happen when we call upvote answer, but will happen when set answers will be executed. So it's inside another callback. This is supposed to work, so let's check. Yeah. Again, there's all of this propagation, okay? We change a state and it will re-trigger all the rendering. This just happens. The good part of React is that you can focus on the state and you see, we first defined all the top-to-down flow information, saying this is the state, from this state, let's build everything else, bypassing properties. And if we do it right, we just do it once. Okay? And then we switch to the evolution of the state. So the building starts from a state which is unknown but constant. I have some state information that's given to me with the properties, and I need to render the page, whatever it is. Then if the list number of elements changes, it's everything computed from the props. So we are in one mindset where everything is constant. Props are constant, state is constant, we need to build the page, render phase. Then another part of the application deals with handling the changes. So setting the event handlers that are called when something interesting happens, and implementing the state change functionalities. But here we are only focused on correctly updating the state. We don't care about where the state goes, what do we have to update. It's already solved for us. Okay, there's no problem. Okay, this value is changed. This value is displayed in 7 places, so we need to update it in 7 places. No, it's all automatic. Huh? It's automatic. It's the job of React to propagate the state changes. Okay, so this is quite good because we are separating our concerns, and let's try not to mix them. The render phase and the update phase. Render, everything is constant, we just have to display it. The update phase, in update, the interface doesn't exist. We don't care about the interface. We just care about the state variables. And the rule is that all the state change functions should be inside the same component that owns the state. And this component just decides which of their children or which children are allowed to call this method. Okay. So we have this top-down information flow and reverse data flow. And this reverse and so it's implemented by passing down all the callbacks. If we have many callbacks, it may become boring to pass all of them. So one possibility would be to collect all the callbacks in one object. No? Maybe we could have one object called actions, or actions, for example, where we collect delete answer and upvote answer, for example. And then pass down this object as a prop. So instead of passing separately delete answer and upvote answer, we pass some actions property. Actions equal to props.actions, action equal to props.action down there, until we reach the end and we just use props.actions.updelete, props.actions.upvote or something like that. But it's just a matter of using the objects, okay? Or how we call if all the actions needs to go to the same component, it's good to keep them together. If they should go to different components, it's better to keep them separated. but it's just a matter of managing our own code according to what's better for us. Okay. We didn't discuss the last functionality here, the add functionality. There are two components here for implementing the add functionality. One is, of course, implementing the callback. And the other is how to manage these text fields here. Okay? Implementing text fields is a bit of a complex topic. It's not complex, it will take more time than we have today. So for today, I will focus on the callback for adding new answers. So it means that we are to define a new function, const, addAnswer. And this function needs some parameters, all the values of the function itself, of the answer itself. It needs a date, a text, and an author. Date, text, author. So basically, the add button should call this in a way that we'll see next time, should call this method here with these two parameters. And once we have these parameters, what we have to do is basically to create a new answer with this data. But of course, we have some extra a new answer. ID, text, we need to provide the ID. The text is already there, the author is there, the score is zero, and the date is there. And once we have the new answer, we should append this answer to the list of answers. So it will be some set answers of what? Of a list with all the answers plus the new one. Let's call it new answer. New. I'm not doing a push because I don't modify the array. I'm creating a new array by duplicating the old one and appending a new element at the end. Again, I cannot do this here because I need to schedule it in a callback for the same reason as before. I'm modifying the state by including the old value. And so it should all be in a callback. The idea is this one, but we must do it in the callback. So set answers, and we have a callback from the old answers to a new value. Now we need, it's not just an expression, we need to do some computation, so we do that in a body, in a function body, that creates a new answer. So I'm putting this information here, and then I return the new array, like this. Not answers, but old answers. Okay, so I'm moving this code into the callback by using the parameter of the callback as a starting point instead of the current state value. And now we have, of course, to provide the answer The ID is the problem, because I need to generate a new ID. What I could do is to take the maximum of the current IDs and add one, for example. There is no max in the JavaScript standard library, or is there a method max? Do we have it? I don't remember. Method max, yes. Okay, I can spread an array and have it the maximum. Good. So the new const, new ID, can be computed by the max, math.max. And now I need to create an array with all the IDs. So a simple map will do, and then I will spread the result of this map, because the max doesn't accept an array, but accept a list of parameters. So I'm spreading the old answers, but remember, old answers, not the answers map, where every answer is replaced by its ID. Plus one, maybe. Okay, I don't promise it's working. It needs some debugging, but since we have this, if it's working, new ID, we can create a new object with a new ID, the current text, current date, current author. And oh, sorry, I forgot the score, 0. The same name, but the same order. Okay, what's wrong? ID, text, author, score, date. ID, text, author, score, date. I was doing a mess. Okay. Apart from some debugging that probably is needed, this is the idea. Again, the trick is always to, when we have a state which is composed as an array, every time we do some modification of a state, we need to set a callback that will create a new array with the proper modifications. If you want to have a look, I don't lose time now because the time is over, but at the end of the other chapter about forms, there is some examples of how to add items, updating items in the list, in the list of objects, and removing items and so on. Okay, so there's some code examples that are for the most frequent operations, like we did today together. Okay, see you next Tuesday. Thank you.